Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for being here at this late hour. I'm very honoured that you've decided to sit in. Thank you. And let me see. So my presentation is going to be about travel technology latest trends. As with the other events that I've done here today, if you want a copy of my presentation, just leave your business card at the back on the way out, and then I'll email you when it's up and online. If you've already given a business card, no need to do so again. Good. So what I'd like to talk about today, I'd like to talk about 10 facts about how the digital world is changing, how we need to adapt to the digital world. And then I'd just like to touch on some latest technology, because that was the title of the presentation. But some of the latest technology we've been talking about, and I'll show you, I don't think is particularly relevant to how we do business, but it'll be good to look at. So let's talk about 10 facts about the digital world. Fact one, digital customers are different. And this means the way you need to do business is going to have to change to actually adapt to addressing this new digital customer marketplace. So let's have a look at who they are. And Generation C, and can we run that video, Ben? Okay, enough of that video. Generation C, I call them Generation C because they're the connected generation. And take my daughter, for example. She used to have a smartphone. She likes her gadgets. She had a nice iPhone. That's old-fashioned now. She sold that on eBay. She's got a very cheap old-fashioned Nokia now, and she's now communicating on her tablet. So she doesn't actually want to talk to anyone anymore. She'll talk to people, converse, not by voice, but by social media. And Facebook is old hat as well. How many people on Facebook? Okay. If you were all 16-year-olds, you probably find just half the number are now on Facebook. Facebook is not really being used by the connected generation anymore. It's becoming a place for old fogies like us. But Generation C is more formally known as Generation Z, well, Z in English. So let's run this video now, Ben.
Millennials are so last year. As the generation that inspired countless think pieces eases out of the public eye, marketers are honing in on the next wave of consumers, Generation Z. These folks, born in 1995 or later, make up 25.9% of the United States population, contribute $44 billion to the American economy, and differ from their predecessors in a few key ways. While millennials, aka Generation Y, grew up alongside the World Wide Web, Gen Z is growing up with social media. As the average Facebook user gets older, more than 25% of 13 to 17-year-olds left the network in 2013. Instead, Gen Z favors Snapchat, Whisper, and Secret, ephemeral and visually engaging platforms that cater to the youngsters' 8-second attention span.
So that's Generation Z. You see, they're leaving Facebook behind. It doesn't mean Facebook's not a good advertising medium for you. It means as your businesses progress, your digital strategy might have to change to suit the new generation. But I've taken some of these ideas from a senior marketing director, Thomas Cook, and I know there he said that his biggest barrier to actually change within Thomas Cook were actually the internal ones, that actually it's his organization that's holding him back. And he had to work very hard within his organization to bring the people internally on board to thinking there's a new way of having to do business now. If you're going to address your digital customers, that you can't do things in the old way. I remember when Thomas Cook Direct was first launched. It was one of the very first online websites. It was launched with a call center support. So it was thomascook.com being supported by the Thomas Direct call center. If you did some business on thomascook.com and you walked into one of their shops, one of their retail units, and said, look, I just bought a holiday on your website, the staff there would look at you as if you were mad and say, well, it's nothing to do with us. We don't earn any money from you buying a holiday on the website. Just go and phone them up. And so Thomas Cook had to completely re-engineer their organization to start adapting for the modern world. That's quite an old example, but it gives you a feel for where we are. So there are skeptics that need to be brought on board, and you need to think in your organization, if you're going to move and adapt for the digital world, who is it within your organization that might be holding you back? And are there new relationships that need to be formed, new ways of reorganizing your business to cope with the digital world? And what we're talking about is a digital transformation for your business. So we're not talking maybe about the mobile people there and the social media people there. It's a complete transformation of your business. Let's talk about that. Can we just run this video? We'll be right back. thank you, Capgemini, for that. We're in an interesting industry because we're actually selling a product, a physical product, although we could actually deliver it on virtual reality. But we are selling a physical product, and yet it's only information at the point of sale. When we sell the product, it's like a music download or like an ebook. It's only information when we sell it. So we are actually, when we're selling, we're an information industry, digital industry. We do have to deliver the product. And if you're an intermediary, like an online travel agent, maybe you're totally digital. If you're running a hotel, as some of you might be, some kind of attraction, you have a physical product, but you're still in the digital industry when it comes to selling. So you have to remember that. And it might be that your IT department, if you have one, are actually your new best friends. They should be your new best friends because they're the ones who are going to help you the most to deliver what you need to deliver out to the market. Hands up who's in IT here. We'll give you a nice cuddle later because we love you now. but here's the IT crowd. They're your new best friends. So let them come out from the basement and make them part of your high-level decision-making. Make sure they're involved. Because unfortunately, if you're an MD of a business and you've been running it for the last 30, 40 years quite successfully, you might not realize what online IT digital opportunities there might be unless you talk to your IT people. I remember at the start of the internet, we had a few more large tour operators in the UK than we have now. One of them was called Air Tours in those days. Some of you will have heard of Air Tours, eventually acquired by Thomas Cook. When everyone started to go online, the board of directors at Air Tours didn't even have a PC on their desks. I mean, they just weren't interested in computing at all. Until about 2 years down the line of the new online world of travel, they started panicking and suddenly decided to rebrand to My Travel and throw away years and years of brand power and just wreck their business so they had to sell it in the end. So don't let that happen to you. If you've been in business for a long time, you've got to find somewhere, talk to your IT people, understand the digital opportunities. And let's just run this video, because I like this video.
What is it?
This, Jen, is the internet.
What?
That's right.
This is the internet. The whole internet.
Yep. I asked for a loan of it so that you could use it in your speech.
It's so small.
That's one of the surprising things about it.
Hang on. It doesn't have any wires or anything.
It's wireless.
Oh, yes, everything's wireless nowadays, isn't it? So I can really use it in my speech. What if someone needs it?
Oh, no. People will still be able to go online and everything. It'll still work.
Oh, good.
I tell you, you present this to the shareholders and you will get quite a response.
Can I touch it? It's so light.
Of course it is, Jen. The internet doesn't weigh anything.
No, of course it doesn't.
Hey! What is Jen doing with the internet?
Ma said I could use it for my speech.
Are you insane? What if she drops it?
I won't drop it. I'll look after it.
No, Jen. No, this needs to go straight back to Big Ben.
Big Ben?
Yeah, it goes on top of Big Ben. That's where you get the best reception.
All right, I promise I won't let anything happen to it.
No, Jen, I'm sorry. But the elders of the internet would never stand for it.
No, Roy, I spoke to the elders of the internet not 1 hour ago. I told them about Jen winning Employee of the Month, and they were so impressed that they wanted to do whatever they could to help.
Wait a minute. The elders of the internet. The elders of the internet know who I am. You've got to let me have it.
No, Jen, I'm sorry. It's just too risky.
Oh, please, Roy. Oh.
Well, Moss, has it been completely demagnetized?
By Stephen Hawking himself. Who sent his congratulations, by the way.
Well, if it's okay with the hawk.
So, can I have it?
You can.
Oh, don't forget your speech.
Oh, thank you.
Shh. Slowly.
Well, I hope your IT department's not like that. That was a little combative there. You need to understand where your customer's coming from. If you've sat in some of my other sessions today, we spoke a lot about talking to customers, and a lot of companies now are mapping their customer journeys, understanding the touch points across multiple devices so that they just know how your customer's interacting with you and what they want from you. You need to know that. Let's just look at this quick video about customer journey maps.
Hi, I'm Megan Grocki from MadPow, and today I'll be showing you how to create customer journey maps. Journey maps are a visual interpretation of an individual's relationship with an organization, service, product, or brand over time and across channels. A journey map helps us explore answers to the what-ifs that arise during research and conceptual design. They should include items like personas, a timeline, the emotions being felt by customers, touch points, and channels where the interactions are taking place. So how does one create a customer journey map? There are 9 key steps. Number 1, review the goals for the product or service. Number 2, gather our research. Some of my favorite research methods include customer interviews, contextual inquiry, customer surveys, customer support logs, web analytics, social media, and competitive intelligence.
Number 3, generate a list of customer touchpoints and the channels on which those touchpoints occur. For example, the touchpoint could be pay a bill, and the channels associated with that touchpoint could be pay online, pay in person, or pay via mail.
Number 4, conduct an exercise called an empathy map. Empathy maps depict the various facets of a persona and his or her experiences in a given scenario. The goal of the empathy map is to get a sense of how it feels to be that customer in this experience. Number 5, brainstorm with what we call lenses. This means we generate ideas in a short period of time with words representing key concepts, brand attributes, or mindsets that help us look at a problem in a different way. Number 6, complete an affinity diagram where we organize ideas and find cohesion in the team's concepts. It helps us focus on the right solutions for this audience. Number 7, this is the part you've been waiting for, sketching the journey. This is where we put together all the ideas the team generated for how to improve the future customer journey. Get creative on how you lay it out. There's no one way of sketching a customer journey. Number 8, refine and digitize. If visual design isn't your strong suit, consider collaborating with someone who can turn your journey map into an impressive artifact. And lastly, number 9 is to share them with zeal. Shout from the rooftops and display them prominently in common areas. That's all. I hope you found this useful, and best of luck in creating your own journey maps.
Thank you very much. Let's have a look at a couple of different ones. Here's a very simple one. I don't know if you can see that at all. We've across the top is different channels that people might make contact with you. And down the side, I think, if I can read it, down the side of the different, I can't read my own slide there. Down the side of the different ways people might contact you: website, phone, word of mouth, and across the top are the different activities that might be done. That's one form of journey map that you could fill in. That's a fairly generic one. Here's another form. I won't go into it. There's someone arriving at a hotel, another journey map. And then, let me just go back again. Yeah, I'll come to more journey maps in a minute. The point is about this mapping is your customers are with you for life. And that means you've got to map them all the way through their interactions with you, not just when they're booking, not just when they're on holiday with you, but also afterwards until they come round again to buy again. So we're not considering them just for a campaign, they're actually for a circle of life. So we could play the circle of life video, but I won't do that unless you'd like to hear it. But the point is, it's a circle of customer life. That's the point. So here's Thomas Cook's customer map, where they start off with dreaming, planning, booking, departing, at the bottom there, arriving, experience in destination, returning home, and sharing. In fact, that sharing is not in the quite in the right place, because I think that your customer will be sharing all the way through that customer journey map, from when they first are dreaming of what they might want to go on holiday and what they might want to do. They might be sharing that fact. They might find the great holiday they're going to book with you and want to share that. So the sharing happens all the way through. So if you took that circle of customer life, as I've called it there, because it's heart-shaped, because it's Thomas Cook, you might think, now, what are the devices that people are going to use at each of that stage, and how will they be interacting with you at each stage through that journey? Here's a more generic one, a travel purchase cycle, where at the top we start with a recommend and review, which might be happening on social media, review sites, maybe across one's personal network, and then looking for inspiration, which might come from your website, or it might come from Pinterest, or maybe from emails you're sending out, trying to get that inspiration. Research will probably very definitely be coming to your website, but that might be on a PC, on a tablet, it might be on mobile, or it might be that the customer actually picks up the phone and phones you. It's been known to happen. And then the customer starts targeting, homing in what they want to choose, selecting it, and so we go around that circle of customer life. So maybe think about doing a diagram like this for your own business, and think about how the customer's interacting with you and where you can improve things for them. And you need to be thinking digital first. So this might mean that when you start looking at your customer circle of life, that actually you need to redesign your business a bit to actually be more customer facing, where they actually meet with you and where they want to communicate with you. And you might also have to be thinking about video now. We touched on this in my last presentation, social media, where we were looking at lovely pictures on Facebook. And apparently, if you weren't in the room, if you're putting pictures of travel product on Facebook, always try and include water. People love to see water, apparently. That's what I was told. And maybe start thinking video, which isn't very easily done, because it takes a lot more to purpose a video. Can we run this one, Ben? Thank you. It's a problem video. I don't like video, and I don't like it on your behalf because the cost of production of a video is just, and the amount of time and trouble you have to go to create a video is so much more than a decent photograph. And I'm not sure what to do about it, but I do know it does work. I remember a few years ago looking at a UK online travel company called Direct Line Holidays. They were trying to make it very easy for people to book holidays. These are simple package holidays, nothing very special. And they actually came up with a one-page booking form to actually book online. You didn't have to click through one page. That was wonderful. What they found, though, was on their homepage, it was not very nice looking, had lots of little squares, and the squares were pictures of package holidays you might buy from Direct Line Holidays. Those squares that you clicked on and which clicked through to videos converted at a hugely higher rate than those that were just photographs. Video does work. It's very annoying. And it did work for Direct Line Holidays, so they sold the business for lots of millions of pounds. So it worked for them. And I'm afraid video, whether we like it or not, is happening. The problem is, you're never quite sure what video is going to work and what's not going to work. There have been some viral videos on YouTube which have generated millions and millions and millions of views. I think there was an Australian campaign, there was an island, I forget which it was now, in Australia, that was looking to recruit a new nature reserve keeper. And they asked their potential job applicants to submit videos of how they might go about looking after the island. I forget which island it was. Does anyone remember the name of the island? Hamilton Island, thank you very much. That was it. That worked really well for them. I've seen videos which have been professionally done, are quite amusing, and gone onto YouTube, and they've had, I don't know, 20 views, 50 views. And you can see this was a professionally put together video, very cleverly scripted, quite amusing, probably cost £10,000 to do, and have just fallen by the wayside. But I think with your own products, you do need to be thinking about what you need to be doing video-wise, because it's happening and it's proven that it does raise conversions. I'm sorry to have to say that, because I wish we didn't have video. It's a pain, but it has to be done. We're in an omni-channel world now. This is a fairly new phrase. We're no longer multi-channel. We were talking about multi-channel a few years ago. I was very excited talking about multi-channel. We're now talking about omni-channel. I'll show you the difference. Here is multi-channel. You've got a person who might access the business through a variety of channels, but the business, rather like the Thomas Cook example I said, might be a little bit disjointed. Whereas omni-channel retail is giving a single view of your business to the customer across all channels the customer might want to look at you on, whether they phone you, walk into your shop, access you on their tablet or their laptop or their mobile, they get this consistent view. And so from the retailer's point of view, your point of view, you get this single view of the customer across channel. That's very difficult to do. I'll come back to that in a minute. And from your point of view as well as a business owner, you get a single view of the customer's data. So it's like a one-to-one relationship. The customer sees you consistently, sees your business consistently, however they actually communicate with you, whichever device they use. On the other hand, you actually are surrounding the customer with your business and you have a single view of your customer. This is very difficult to do, and I'll tell you why. Because in the olden days, when we just had the web, you could run Google Analytics on your website and you could understand exactly how your customers are interacting with you, and you could actually get good statistics. You could look at the conversion of lookers to bookers, and get return on investments and cost per acquisition, lots of information like that. If your customer's coming to you via their tablet, via the mobile, whether that's a mobile website or an app, reaching you online, it makes it much harder for you to track the customer and actually follow that individual customer's journey with you. The only way I think round it, unless someone's going to tell me otherwise, is actually to get your customer to log in to you, to actually have an identity with you and log in. So I'll give you an example, an easy one. I use Amazon so much now. I just do all my shopping in Amazon. If I'm sitting in front of my laptop, I'm logged in, and they know who I am. If I'm using my mobile phone and I might be scanning a barcode on a bottle or something like that, I'm also logged in because I need to buy something from them. So they have a complete view of me. That's not so easily done in the world of travel. I don't really know how to tackle that now. But we're finding that marketing people, online marketing people, when they're trying to attribute the a sale, a booking, back to its source, they may attribute it to a single source, which might be the website, because the analytics allow them to do that. But they might be completely ignoring the fact that that customer was reacting with your business through their mobile, through their tablet, and actually the only thing you're attributing is the final booking. So you might conclude, if you're doing final booking attribution like that, that actually mobile is not very successful for you. Your tablets don't really work for you at all, your tablet website. So I'm not sure what the answer is about that. I haven't got a solution to that at all, other than maybe if your customers are fairly regular customers, if you can give them a reason to submit their email address and log in, and that they might do that across multiple devices. Amazon, great example. I need to log in on my phone if I'm using that to do shopping. The same with eBay that I use on my phone. The same maybe with when I'm using my British Airways app or my EasyJet app. That's fine. But if I was going to thomascook.com, I'll carry on with that example. Thomas Cook on my phone, they just wouldn't know I was there. I don't think they'd pick that up at all. Not an easy solution, but for yourselves, the idea is, as much as possible, is for you to have the single view of the customer across all channels, and for the customer, I suppose this is more important, for the customer to feel they're having a single view of your business, consistent view. So if they're shopping on your mobile app or your mobile website for a skiing holiday, it's actually the same price as on your website and at your call centre. Although I have seen a ski tour operator who always makes sure the call centre prices are higher, and tell the customer, sorry, if you want the best price, you've got to shop online. And that actually means they can slowly but surely reduce the size of their call center as customers just leave the call center behind. So let's look at the digital cornerstones. Digital asset management, haven't really spoken about that at all. Customer relationship management, I've sort of been touching on that. And analytics, I've just touched on that. Let's look at digital asset management, see what that's all about.
Marketing today is about getting as much content in front of as many eyeballs in as many ways as possible. Or is it about getting the right content in the right form to the right people at the right time? Whatever your school of thought, digital asset management helps you do just that and more. CMO's top priorities are marketing ROI, customer retention, brand loyalty, positioning and differentiation, and customer satisfaction. Now that's a lot of high-level mumbo-jumbo, but honestly, how can we work toward any of these top marketing priorities without being able to effectively control, repurpose, and measure what is the lifeblood of our marketing, our digital media and brand assets? You see, DAM makes it possible to make sure your busy sales reps and marketing partners can easily get the latest and greatest assets so they can work harder and smarter for you. It allows you to centralize, organize, and tag assets from Agency A and Agency B so you know exactly what you have and where it is. DAM allows you to make sure your channel partners can access assets intended for their markets and not those they don't need anyway. When you need an asset for a print brochure, PowerPoint presentation, web page, and Facebook post, you can make sure you get the asset repurposed and converted to the right format for each medium automatically. No thinking, no blinking, just click and download. Meanwhile, you can prepare and collaborate on entire collections of assets for your next campaign securely in the same location. Need to know what's working for you, who's using your stuff, where, and how? That's easy. All the intel you need is in DAM.
Okay, it doesn't sound the world's most exciting thing, but it's actually a big problem for travel businesses that have so much visual media, videos and photos and descriptions of hotels and the like. You need to think about centralizing them all in a central digital asset database, and from there, let them be pulled out or pushed out to the devices where they need to be displayed, whether that's in-house in your call center, or whether it's going out to someone's mobile phone, having the digital assets repurposed on the way out, so that when you update a photograph of your swimming pool, you do it in just one place. I think we all might be guilty of having lots of our information assets and our photographs in more than one place. And when you change it here, you've got to change it there as well, and change it at the place in the middle. That might be a familiar story to you. So part of my three digital cornerstones, really need four, because if it's a three, something's going to fall over and missing a leg, but it's only three, is actually having your digital assets in one place. And customer relationship management. What is it you want to know from your customers? Who are your customers? What identifies your kind of customer? Do you know who your kind of customer is? And what's different about their different customer journeys? Say your kind of product that appeals to someone who's in their early 20s and someone who's in maybe in their mid 50s as well. Are their customer journeys different? Do they have different personas? How can you appeal to them? What do you need to do? What touch points do they use and when? We've touched on that. And try and put yourself in their shoes. What are they expecting from you? Whatever they're expecting from you, you need to give them. You need to manage their expectations. Don't confuse them. And who influences them and how do they influence them? If you understand that, you'll understand how to influence them better. So let's move. So that's just some thoughts on CRM. Let's move along to onto analytics. I love this. That's I think it's a needle with a little bit of R work in the middle, because big data and analytics is actually about the small details that count. For example, you're a travel agent and someone walks into your store and you've known them for years and years because they always shop from you, and you actually know that the customer's wife is a keen swimmer, and you can't even suggest a swimming pool that's less than 25 meters at a hotel. They just wouldn't be interested. It's a small bit of data. Very easy to do that in a small retail unit. Actually, getting that right is much harder, to get those details and get them stored away. So big data is about small data, but lots and lots and lots of it, and analyzing it and being able to bring it forward to actually personalize and customize your offering to your customers. So talking about little details, I like this clip from Sherlock Holmes.
It really is quite a thrill to meet you, Mr. Holmes. I've heard so much about you. I have a pile of detective novels at home, Wilkie Collins, Poe.
It's true.
It can seem a little far-fetched, though, sometimes, making these grand assumptions out of such tiny details.
That's not quite right, is it? In fact, the little details are by far the most important. Take Watson.
I intend to.
See his walking stick, a rare African snake wood, hiding a blade, 5 tensile steel. A few were awarded to veterans of the Afghan War, so I can assume he's a decorated soldier. Strong, brave, born to be a man of action.
And?
Neat, like all military men. Now, I check his pockets. Ah, a stump from a boxing match. Now, I can infer that he's a bit of a gambler. I'd keep an eye on that dowry if I were you.
Those days are behind me.
Right behind you. It's cost us the rent more than once.
Well, with all due respect, Mr. Holmes, you know John very well. What about a complete stranger? What can you tell about me?
You? I don't think that's... I don't know that that's...
Not a dinner.
Perhaps some other time.
I insist.
You insist?
You remember we discussed this.
The lady insists. You're a governess.
Well done.
Yes, well done. Shall we... Waiter.
Your student. It's a boy of age.
Charlie 7, actually.
Finished tour for his age. He flicked ink at you today.
Is there ink on my face?
There's nothing wrong with your face.
There are 2 drops on your ear, in fact. India blue is nearly impossible to wash off. Anyway, a very impetuous act by the boy, but you're too experienced to react rashly, which is why the lady for whom you worked lent you that necklace. Oriental pearls, diamonds, a flawless ruby, hardly the gems of governors. However, the jewels you are not wearing tell us rather more.
Holmes.
You were engaged. The ring has gone, but the lighter skin where it once sat suggests that you spent some time abroad wearing it proudly. That is, until you were informed of its true and rather modest worth, at which point you broke off the engagement and returned to England for better prospects. Doctor, perhaps.
Okay, well, this is one of the problems with big data, so I just had to run the whole clip through to there. I like that bit. It might be possible to get it wrong. I remember a story of a gentleman turning up with his family at a British Airways check-in desk. You know, when we used to have check-in desks, we don't have them anymore. They were nice old things. And to get his tickets, and he was being bumped off the flight and being given a really hard time. What British Airways hadn't realised was actually he was the chief executive of one of their biggest corporate customers, and they lost a massive, massive account by not realising who he was. So personalisation, customisation is very important to know your customer, but you do run the risk, as Sherlock Holmes did, that maybe if you personalise something so beautifully, actually you might have got it wrong. So make sure you get your personalisation right, that's all I can say. Don't be like Sherlock Holmes. And maybe a way of doing this is to involve your customers to help understand them. So speak to your customers. Invite them to workshops and to talk about your products and processes. Don't sit there in your offices wondering what you should be selling your customers, what your customers like and don't like. Actually ask them. You'd be surprised how responsive they might be. And number 10. This is not an easy thing to do. A digital transformation, actually starting to adapt your business for the digital age, is just hard work. It's very, very difficult. But I don't think we have a choice but to do it. So those are some dominoes there. Let's look at these, the Domino's World Record, which can't have been easy to set up at all. Can we run that, Ben?
Dominoes may come in one shape, but they can come in all sizes. Ones that children can push over, ones that humans can become. But how you put them together is the real skill. And the crucial start all rests on that one finger. This team in Germany was aiming to smash the world record for most dominoes falling in a spiral. So did they do it? Over 50,000 dominoes in the spiral, but that was only the start of it. They had actually stacked 277,000 dominoes and took the audience on a journey, literally. As the constant clacking filled the air, they could see notable landmarks and people. And just when you thought the excitement was fading, they added in a bit of tension. In the interest of a fair and balanced report, it didn't all go to plan. One of the pyramids didn't collapse. The second streamer on the wall didn't go off. The race cars didn't start. But who cares? It was still a pretty amazing attempt, considering it took the team over a week to set up.
So a lot of hard work. It didn't all go to plan, but a lot of it did. So there's no excuse for not trying. Let me move on to my next little section. Let me talk about some 2015 predictions for latest technology. Growth in pervasive connectivity. Wherever you are, you'll be connected. I think that's growing in 2015. I'm on Vodafone, and Vodafone have their Eurotraveller plan, where for £2 a day in Europe, I can be always on my normal tariff. And actually, even the States now, on their world travel, is just £5 a day. I'm now always on, I'm pervasive. But it'd be very nice if we get more of the wide area wireless networking that's been talked about for the last few years. Doesn't seem to be rolled out very much. But if you need Wi-Fi, you just go into Starbucks, so you can't really go wrong with that. Pervasive connectivity, we'll just be always connected. There'll come a day when information will be in your house, well, I think it's already arrived, just as you turn on a tap to run water, actually the connectivity is just built in. It is a bit of a song and a dance right now. You have to sign up with an internet service provider or a telecoms company. It's going to get easier. We talked a little bit today in my previous sessions about the Internet of Things, things that are now all connected to the Internet. So, for example, the refrigerator, the fridge that actually knows what's inside itself and can actually just send you a text or an email when it knows you're running out of milk or orange juice or whatever's in there, that kind of example. And I've touched on this, analytics, part of the big data. I think this is going to be the big thing for 2015 and beyond, that actually communications with companies get more and more personal as analytics gets more and more sophisticated. Autonomous machines, I'll come back to that, machines that do things themselves, and wearables become accepted. We had a show of hands for, is anyone wearing a smartwatch? Don't all fight. Does anyone think they might be wearing one next year? Yeah, you know what, I might put my hand half up. I've got an iPhone. I might have a look at an Apple Watch and see if it's any good for me or not. But I love wearing my other watch right now, so I'll have to wear two, which will be a bit much. And cloud computing continues to roll out, as a lot of celebrities who put their pictures online found out to their cost recently, that there's a lot more being done in the cloud, which goes very usefully with that pervasive connectivity. So, let's have a quick look at wearables. That's the gentleman from Get Smart. I forget what his name was, something smart. He was a 1960s TV spy wearing a smartwatch. And that's wearables. Autonomous machines, there's Kit, which was quite happily drove itself around. If I had a driver with that hairstyle, I'd probably drive myself around. So, there we are. So, let's look at watches. The Apple Watch is just about to launch. We're very excited about this, and I know you want to see their video.
You know, it's driven Apple from the beginning, this compulsion to take incredibly powerful technology and make it accessible, relevant, and ultimately personal. We've designed a range of products so personal, you don't put them on your desk or in your pocket. You wear them on your wrist.
That video runs for a long time, so let's look at the alternative video. Can we run that, Ben?
From the very beginning of time, man has continually asked one question.
Hula pejaet, ¿qué hora es? Mias idu.
What time is it? Today, we at Apple will answer that question. It is time for the iWatch.
We found users constantly reaching for their phones to check the time, and that is the worst. So we figured, why not just strap it to your body?
Introducing our magical new product, the iWatch.
Now, not only can you check the time, but you can check almost any other alert that your phone could push to it. Wow.
The iWatch uses its built-in Bluetooth 4.0 technology to wirelessly communicate with your iPhone. This way, you can answer calls with ease, even when your iPhone is in the other room. Syncing your iWatch to your iPhone happens all in the background with our iSync technology. All you have to do to set this up is pair your existing iPhone with your iWatch. Make sure the confirmation code matches, bump them together, then input the 16-character passcode into each of the devices. It's really that simple. Repeat after every charge.
We have taken this iSync technology much farther than it needs to go. You can respond to text messages without your phone leaving your pocket. Resume your latest ebook with the flick of a finger. Catch up on the latest news headlines pushed directly to your iWatch.
The design that went into the iWatch is unparalleled.
Excellent, there we are. And of course we have Google Glass as well, which has been mentioned at some of my sessions today. Hands up who's worn a Google Glass? No, I haven't either, no. Okay. You've all seen the videos of Google Glass, but I don't know if you've seen this one. Can we run that, Ben?
Thanks for meeting me here.
Yeah, absolutely. Sorry, I didn't know if we were going in for the hug at first.
It's okay, you played it off well.
Thanks.
Well, it's nice to meet you in person.
You too.
Yeah. I like your glasses.
Oh, thanks. I need them to see, so that's why I have them on.
Where did you get them?
I got them online. They're pretty new, but thank you.
Okay.
Thanks. So it's Jennifer...
Swanson.
Swanson. Yeah. Google Jennifer Swanson. That's a lovely name.
Thank you.
Do you like dogs?
I do. How did you know that?
Lucky guess.
And then he said, that's the difference between a Doberman and a Pomeranian.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Yeah.
Okay, glass, take a picture.
What?
No, I was just, I thought I saw something in my glass.
Okay. If there's one thing everybody loves, it's Downton Abbey.
Oh, I love Downton Abbey.
Yeah.
I especially love the one chick, Countess Violet Crowley.
Crowley.
Yes. Her. She's amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she has quite the sharp tongue.
Yeah. Did you know that role was written for her? And by her, I mean actress Maggie Smith.
Wow, we have so much in common.
We really do. Run. Oh, man.
I know, that's what I was saying. He should totally run for president. Politics are so important.
What?
You know, if you're distracted right now...
Oh, no, I'm not distracted. I'm very interested in what you have to say.
Okay. So my thoughts on the European Union are pretty complex. I think a lot of people are sitting around. Nobody's making a decision, and too many people need things not to have someone stand up.
I know exactly what you're talking about. But what about me? Well, right. I'm a pretty simple guy.
Tell her you're a beast in the sack.
I'm a B student.
Yeah, try hard.
But I try
seal
hard.
Seal the deal, baby. Yes,
you
seal
know what?
It. Keep makes sex good.
Okay, glass, end stream.
You want to end streams?
Yeah, I do. I love creeks, hate streams. What can I say?
Hold on a second. Sorry, I don't date guys who use Google Glass.
What are you talking about? 5 minutes ago, you didn't even know what that was.
Siri told me.
I love that video. That almost makes the lads in the room here want to go out and buy Google Glass. It's something like a good $1,500 worth. Let's talk a bit about autonomous technology, which is the other happening thing. I know these aren't very relevant to travel, but they're good fun to look at. Cars, self-parking, driving, and robots. Let's look at that. Driverless cars. This sounds a lovely idea.
Here.
Oh, back I go.
Here at CES in Las Vegas, there's a ton of car technology on display. One of the coolest ones that we found was Audi's piloted driving technology, which allows the car to take over in the most boring situation possible, where you're stuck in stop-and-go traffic on the highway, and your commute, morning commute, afternoon commute, going 10 miles.
Doesn't that look like a dream? Down the bottom left there, that's a Roomba vacuum cleaner. And I actually had one of those, but it ended up going round and round in circles and had to throw it in the bin. And the other things will mow the lawn for you. We're getting these autonomous robots that'll do things by themselves. Here's Asimo, which is Honda's robot.
I've come to Honda's technical studio in Brussels to meet one of their most important representatives, although I'm not quite sure who it is yet. Turns out, who I was about to meet wasn't actually a human, but a robot. Honda's famous humanoid robot, Asimo. Asimo has been designed to interact with humans, so if you reach out your hand, it will shake it. Sensors in its palm detect your touch, while cameras in its head track your movements. Asimo's stabilization technology enables it to react if you upset its balance, moving backwards mid-shake if you push it, or stepping in if you pull it towards you.
Thank you very much.
This latest version of Asimo is the product of almost three decades of development. It all started back in 1986 when Honda built a robot which could walk, albeit very slowly and clumsily. In 1988, it was developed to walk more like a human being, and in 1993, a torso was added. By 1996, Honda's robot had become intimidatingly large, so in 1997, it was shrunk to a less threatening size.
And actually, that robot will run for 40 minutes before its battery goes flat. It's quite nice. There's more pictures of it. I wanted to show you Google robots. Google's into a lot of things, aren't they? They recently acquired a company that specializes in robotics, mainly for military purposes, I think.
Hello.
Okay, there are more robots like that. They have a cheetah robot that will actually run at 29 miles an hour, I think, which is quite good. I thought I'd just close with a video of Hitchbot.
Hello, I am Hitchbot, a robot from Fourth Credit, Ontario. This summer I will be traveling across Canada from coast to coast. I am hoping to make new friends, have interesting conversations, and see new places along the way. As you may have guessed, robots cannot get driver's licenses yet, so I'll be hitchhiking my entire way. My name is Hitchbot. You will have to pick me up.
Believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, Hitchbot's made it all the way from coast to coast across Canada. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you. And it was wonderful you being here. Thank you. If you've sat in on my other sessions during the day, thank you very much indeed.